Hello, Warriors. Good Thanksgiving week, shortened week, holiday Thursday. I believe partial hours on Friday is usually what happens when there's a holiday between a weekend. They shorten the session in most pits. So let's have a great week, Warriors. Everyone with me to make the most out of the time that we have. So I just want to go over a couple of things. If you went with the call of shorting Guppy at 49.40 and you follow me on Twitter, I said cover down in here was around 48. Still believe that this rally could still fail. We've attacked some major weekly support once again. I don't know how many times they're going to attack it. I think it shows up better on the daily. Yeah, it's this line extended across. Oh, different color. Anyway, we're right here again. So it's trying to hold. My assumption, this is finally going to give way on the Guppy. Comes in around 47 and a half. That's a breakout. So we've tested it once. And here we are again. Maybe we get a lift, but short term, just my view, I think it could be short from here with stops over 49. Or if you want to let it breathe, 49.40, risk 100 pips. Because if we do break down, there's potential of 44. I've seen people looking for 46, 44. I've seen it all the way down to 41. So this could turn out to be a descending triangle top. We'll see what happens if we get the breakdown here. I did want to show this daily in euro pound. Well, first let's go to the dollar, because the dollar held this 50-day, pointed it out on Thursday, tried to hold it again Friday. To me, it looks pretty vulnerable, pretty weak bounce off this 50-day moving average. And I think that if EG does turn around, that the dollar index could break down, head back down towards 92, eventually a new low. Everyone with me on the dollar here? And I think that euro pound, which Nick has a big lead on, in her pattern in play here, right here, she was shorting euro pound at 90.20, 89.70. So up over 100 pips on this call. I do see this 50-day moving average, and this is going to be kind of the do or die for me in euro pound. We start closing under here. Nick's going to have a great shot for her target to be filled. The alternate scenario is that we get a reversal day here. Okay, we hold here, and we still make this one more move up towards 91 and change, 91.40. Just arithmetically, from this high at 90.14, that's 140 pips. That would give you 91.50 up here for a potential target, and up there I'd be an aggressive short. So everyone with me on that too. It looks like do or die for euro pound here. Is this just a pullback before another push to clean up the remaining bears? I think more people are bearish this pair than bullish this pair. I'd like to see the bears capitulate over this high and this high to set up a campaign short from up there. Okay, just some Nostra Pinkert stuff for you guys. And you know, the team's been smiling at me with my old Wall Street expression that the bears feast on Thanksgiving and the bulls feast on Christmas. Well, this is what I think is going to happen to the S&Ps, either into Thanksgiving, a day before, something like that. I'll show you on the four. So I think you could be a seller between here and 2580, risking 90. And I'm looking for a tag of this line around 2550, which from here is 25 handles into Thanksgiving. And then the bears will have, you know, have their turkey or maybe chopped up a couple of short-term bulls. Yogi Bear may have had, you know, he'd be full. And then the bulls take over from down here for one more spike high into year end, and that might be it, and then the bigger correction might unfold. But I do have some confidence as this being a one, this being a two, that we could complete down here at 2550-ish. Everyone see that on the S&Ps? Who trades S&Ps in here? Anybody? Give me why if you do. If no one's really interested in it, okay. Well, plenty of you guys do. Hey, Gwen, how are you? Hi, David. Were you able to get in touch with Mandy, Gwen? Okay, thank you, Luca. All right. So that's my view. I still think there's more weakness ahead in the guppy. I think the dollar is going to fail. I think EG, you know, it's a low risk trade here with about a 40 pip stop looking for a reversal day or wait, as Steve Volge would, or the confirmation, wait for a good candlestick. We started off sharply lower, okay, and now we're only down 18 pips on the day. So for a daily reversal, you have to have it on the daily chart to see it. So it needs to close back over 89.14. So we're still 20 pips away from having a reversal day. And I think that, you know, we have the Thanksgiving trade in the S&Ps. Actually, look at this. On a longer term time frame on the daily, I have confluence with the 50-day again down here, right around 2550. So I think there's going to be a magnetic thing. And also, look, guys, under 2540, lights out. Okay. If you do the trade and you want to help it along, I used to teach this in law. It's called the cursor technique. Anyone remember the cursor technique? That's followed me around for a while. So you just put your cursor on the candle, and then you do this. You go one, two, three, go down. One, two, three, go down. Everyone got that?
That crap doesn't work. That doesn't work.
Well, let me ask you this. Have you tried it with a magnet?
No, that doesn't work.
Okay. All right. Anyway, the magnet costs $99.99. Anyway, you know, just trying to wake people up with a little chuckle. What do you think? You think we could pull back into Thanksgiving, buddy?
You know, I mean, I guess. Are you talking about the S&P?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't see any real reason to. I mean,
Saying might make it happen.
Yeah, I mean, you can pray for it, I guess. I mean, you know, use your magnet or whatever. But I don't know. I mean, the market's very well supported ahead of, you know, I think we really are going to see the tax reform get done. And once tax reform gets done, then I think it's anybody's game, but the market's going to stay pretty well supported ahead of that. So
yeah, I'm just looking for a 20 handle clip.
No, so 20 handles, nothing. I mean,
that's what I mean.
Yeah. I think we could, I think we could see a 1250, maybe 1240, you know, or I 25.
And that's the target.
I mean, that's nothing but a sneeze in the market. Yeah. I don't really see any real reason why the market will go down at this point in time. You know, I mean, I could argue, you know, everything under the sun why the stock market should go down, but I don't know if it's really going to ahead of tax reform getting done.
Well, so. I'm glad you're here because, you know, the news that broke about Merkel not having a coalition initially took the euro down, and I know that you deconstruct the fundamentals and tie it in with the euro, and I have no idea on the euro in here. I'm wondering what you're thinking with the fundamental development.
Well, you know, the Germany is trying to set up a coalition or you know, Merkel's all the different parties, and the fact of the matter is, you know, Merkel could you know, just completely reject the idea of having a minority government and have new snap elections, which, you know, it's very confusing because I don't understand the German, political process, not like, you know, so many other people do. Hell, I barely even understand our own U.S. political process other than, you know, more, you know, let alone the German one. So, but Germany is, it's actually weakened the euro a little bit over the weekend. And I had, I still have my only position on the mark on the board right now is a short euro New Zealand from last week. And it's working out well. But other than that, I mean, I think that the euro might stay somewhat pressured, but this is more of a German issue. It's not necessarily a euro issue, but it is, you know, it might, you know, lend.
They're the backbone. And, yeah. I heard them even use the term Megxit, you know, meaning Merkel, like a Megxit, a Merkxit or something like that. I don't know why.
Hey, Blake. Hi.
Hey.
Sorry, guys. Dale. Hi. Sorry to interrupt. Just my two cents. If I'm not included.
No. Go. Please.
When I woke up and I heard the news and all that, I saw the euro selling off, and I got into the chat room straight away. By the way, it was like 5 a.m. Greek time. Don't ask me why. But my first reaction was, okay, this cannot be good for the euro. That's for sure. But when the guys in the chat room asked me, you know, what do you think? I said, look, there is a high chance that we're going to go into new elections, and that can actually have the result of rallying in people behind Angela Merkel and her getting a bigger share. Although it might sound weird, but she could actually get a better result, because look, this is what's at stake now is German stability. So, right. You know, the Germans, they're not, they're smart people. They, you know, when they see that something needs to be done, my view is that if there are elections soon again, Merkel will probably get a bigger percentage. So it might be easier for her to then form a coalition government. So my first reaction was euro, definitely not positive for the euro, but could be not as bad as
later.
You know, yeah, exactly. And we were seeing overnight, you know, before the London market opened, that the euro was down not even 0.5%, the euro dollar. So it wasn't a huge move, you know, and people were saying, you know, well, what the hell is wrong with this? You know, why isn't it down more? And I tried to rationalize it, and you know, that's the explanation I could think of. But overall, definitely not a good thing, but you know, it could be a little bit better than people might fear.
You know, it's interesting if you look at look at it technically. So I'm a little miffed at myself for I had a bid on the euro dollar last week at 117.40. This is a 38% retracement. So if you look at it technically, it's a 38% retracement right here, and I had an order out there to buy it. And then, yesterday after the news, I had to double check to make sure I didn't leave it out there, and I didn't. I had removed it. But technically, it acted exactly like it should. If you look at the chart, I mean, it's amazing how, you know, sometimes these charts are just, you know, it's like, you know, magic, if you will. We came right down to just past the 38% retracement. We retested the broken trend line. We came right to this right here, this zone has been drawn. I've had it on here for since last week, you know, since before we broke, when it went like this, Stelio. So when it broke out to the upside, I've had that support zone, and I figured the 38% retracement was going to hold it. And it did. And, I got up this morning and I'm like, oh, crap, did I? And I couldn't remember because I had slept. I actually slept really well last night. First time in like a couple of weeks. I looked back. I'm like, did I leave that order out there? Did I cancel it? I can't remember. And I'm like, man, I hope I left it out there. And I didn't. So I didn't participate in this bounce. But it acted perfectly. Now, if you go back to your conversation or your comments, Stelios, and I don't know, or I know you have to leave here in a few minutes,
yeah,
but
no worries, yeah.
That was what Theresa May tried to accomplish with her snap election. So what was it, 4 or 5 months ago?
Yeah. And as Craig on the chat is saying very rightly, you know, she's pro Eurostate and she's in you know, pro getting everybody coming to the country and all that. She's not very strict with borders and all that. So that's what she's seeing, exactly the thing that that the UK saw. So yeah, Craig, you're right. And so my view is that at some point she's going to have to relax a little bit with this, not relax, but the opposite. So to get a little bit tighter in terms of that issue, because this is the burning issue for the whole of Europe, really. So if there
it's,
is
it's
to
about
be,
immigration, right?
Exactly, yeah. And if there is to be progress for her and her party, then she has to do something to indicate that, look, you know, we're going to, I have no idea what it could be, but she has to move away from this completely or almost completely lax attitude to immigration. So it's a very difficult, you know, a very difficult call to see what's going to happen. But, you know, we have to remember that Angela Merkel has guided Germany through this Eurozone crisis and they've done so well. They've been flying. So if I was a German, I would be, you know, trying to get her to stay because, you know, it makes sense that the country's done extremely well.
So. Right. That makes a lot of sense. Well, thank you, Stelios, for your input. Are you going to be back in about 20 minutes or so?
Yeah, 15, 20 minutes. I'll be back. 15 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll let you run. I'm going to run through some of these majors really quick. So thanks okay. for your input. Okay. And Steve is not going to be with us today. He had some personal things he had to tend to. So so I'm going to be here with Stelios today, and we're gonna cover and Dale. What I thought we'd do is cover some of these majors. Like I said, I'm surprisingly light on my positions. I closed out all of my yen on Friday, and it's been a great trade. I just scalped the dollar yen to the short side just a little while ago, but I've got no yen exposure at the moment. I want to have yen exposure, but when's the last time you've heard me say I don't have yen exposure?
Since a high.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, it's I've actually been a short dollar yen or, you know, long yen pretty much since right here.
How much of a rally are you looking for to start stepping into it again?
Well, I've got a couple orders that are outstanding that are near the 1250 level. So and frankly, here, let me I think it is. You know, it's Monday. You got mutual fund Monday, if you will. You get, you know, the market might try to rally a little bit. I really think that the dollar yen is broken. So any type of rally is going to be very short lived. But if we could get a rally towards 1250, and here, let me just draw this out.
Flag.
Yeah, somewhere around here. I'm a seller all through here, all through these levels. So I'm trying to be patient. Like I said, I just shorted the dollar yen at 112.25 and I closed it at 112.14. Just moments ago, the guys and gals that were in the chat room, they saw, you know, I sold it right here and I covered it right there. I mean, it was just an in and out type of thing. But I am a seller up here towards 1250. And this is ultimately where I want to be on the short side. I'm just hoping we get there. I'm a little nervous that we won't get there, and I don't want to miss the boat. You know, I don't want to miss out on the downside. But I'm trying to be patient as well. You know, other than just kind of scalping around, I really want to, you know, take a foothold, being short the dollar yen and some of these yen pairs. But let's really quick take a look at all the majors and, you know, the euro dollar. This is a pretty. This was a really important place that we really pivoted from. It's huge. I mean, technically, it showed the market showed its hands in the euro dollar and in the dollar index for that matter. You can see specifically where, as long as we stay above, let's just call it 117.25. As long as we stay above 117.25, there's no reason to really be on the on the short side of the euro at this point. And I like it when the market shows me its hand like that. It's like, okay, well, I know exactly where the euro gets bearish, and I know exactly, it's just bullish until then. That doesn't mean I want to run out and buy the euro right now. But I'll tell you, if we dip towards 117.50, I wouldn't mind taking a shot at it again. If we come down here, and that's, again, I love it when I can, get up in the morning like today and I know exactly where that price is, where is that line in the sand that the market has drawn where the euro is bullish or bearish. And that for me is right in this support zone. It's perfectly clear. Okay. It doesn't mean that I'm going to make money. It doesn't mean that that if it comes down here and I buy it, that I'm going to make money. But I know that if it comes down here, I could buy it and put a stop in really, really tight and not risk a lot, and that's key, as a trader. You're just trying to figure out where's the best risk reward point. Let's take a look at the cable. Now, the cable has been strong, but we drew this out last week. Okay. And Steve, found this like itty bitty triangle inside of a bigger triangle. And I'll tell you, I'm just not excited about the pound at all whatsoever while it's in here. But we might be like literally a couple of weeks away from a major breakout. The pound could resume its upside. It could resume its downside. I think anything is game here. I think if you were listening to Steve, he really is more focused on a resumption of downtrend. But that doesn't necessarily mean that's going to happen. I mean, everything that's happening out of the cable is probably going to be Brexit related. So it depends what the headline is that takes it out of this formation or what. So you got to kind of look for some confirmation on why is the pound breaking. If you look at like the Aussie and the Kiwi, still bearish, both of them. And the Aussie is just, I mean, this is like nonstop bludgeoning of the Aussie dollar. And we are quickly approaching a trend line support. And that trend line support is going to be right through here around 75 cents. So, while we're only 50 pips away, 50 or 60 pips away from really critical support. But
yeah, Greg and Steve are completely on this whole move.
On the bearish Aussie move?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's no reason to be bullish the Aussie at this point. I don't see any reason, not the Aussie dollar, but once we get down to 75 cents, I think I'm going to have to reassess the situation and see if it's something that, I'd want to take advantage of, or, are we going to look for a further breakdown? But, the way you look at relative strength here, and we're dipping into or getting very close to oversold territory on the daily chart. So I'm going to be a little nervous about trying to get short the Aussie US dollar once we get down here. That doesn't necessarily mean I want to be long, but maybe I might play the Aussie on some crosses. The Kiwi. Now, the Kiwi, this is interesting, and this is one of the things that this is one of the reasons why I went short the Euro New Zealand late last week, is the Kiwi, we had this breakdown, okay, and then we closed right at the breakdown point. Okay, so the Kiwi, even though it's, I still feel that it's bearish, it's kind of, it's trying to hold up here. I don't think you can rule out a move to, the 66, 66, maybe 67 cents. I don't think you can rule that out, but it is holding up relatively well right now. And so, and this is one of the things that if we did get a false breakdown and we just start bouncing again back to 70 cents, this is really just going to help that Euro New Zealand lower. The dollar Swiss, very choppy. We had, on Friday, we had probably the best rejection you could possibly ask for the dollar Swiss. We went right to previous support. You can see it right here. previous support acted as current resistance at 99.50 basically, and we rejected, and came right back down again. And so that to me is very defining for the dollar Swiss. I'm not trading it. I have, like, there's no reason right now for me to be, you know, trading the dollar Swiss. I don't see any, like, anything that's jumping out at me. But that rejection on Friday was pretty key. The dollar Canadian, extremely messy. We have rejected the 618 retracement here. But again, this is a very similar situation. Is I don't see any real reason to be, you know, trading the dollar Canadian at this point. And this trend line right here is probably the most. Yeah, it's probably very significant, and you could argue the point that as long as it stays above this red trend line here, you could just be on the long side if you want. I know a lot of traders in the Forex Analytics chat room are very bullish the dollar Canadian, or probably more bearish the Canadian currency because of the lopsided positioning on the market. You know, and speculators being very long the Canadian currency. So I think if you're going to trade the dollar Canadian to the long side, you just, you know, you keep your stops relatively close. You know, you can probably keep them just below this 127 and change level, and just, you know, stay long. I mean, I think that's a possibility. The Nordic, you know, what's really interesting also, Dale, these Nordic currencies are extremely weak. Look at the US dollar, Norwegian krona. I mean, this thing has been. I mean, we're back above the 200-day moving average today. It doesn't matter what crude oil is doing. This thing is extremely strong, and I think if you break above this right here, you can see this blue line. This is 830. If you break above 830, then Norwegian krona currency is going to get walloped.
Yeah, you know what, Blake? That I think people should take a picture of that, because there's a breakout that if you weren't paying attention and you didn't get long on the breakout, it's not giving you five chances to think about it.
It's not. And
that's a perfect breakout.
I missed this move right here that day that it broke out. And I'm still to this moment just very frustrated that I forget what my attention was on that day, but I knew this was the breakout point. And I think there was some data behind it on top of the dollar move. But this is the same inverted head and shoulder pattern that broke out when the dollar index broke out. So you can see right here, this is the same day. So the dollar index broke higher, the US dollar Norwegian krona broke higher. But the difference here, yeah, I mean, well, the difference is that the U.S. dollar Norwegian krona has continued to stay strong, where the dollar
never looked back, gave you another chance to buy the neckline like the dollar did. That's what I mean. It's true, because you had to be there the day it did it. And then you're waiting for a pullback to see if it tests it. It doesn't give it to you. Gives you a classic bull flag, not even close to the breakout. Yeah, these are the true breakouts that do not give people a chance, three, four times by the area. So really beautiful looking.
Yeah, it is. And it's getting to that point. I think we get above 830 where it's going to squeeze people, because, you know, how many people are shorting the US dollar Norwegian krona and US dollar Swedish krona is the same way. You know, they're shorting these or playing the Nordic currencies to the long side, thinking, okay, well, we got a failure in the dollar index, so I might as well just get long some Norwegian krona or get long some Swedish krona. And they're finding themselves in a real negative position, because you're right, it's both of them are grinding higher. I mean, look at the US dollar Swedish krona is at the 618 retracement. We're breaking into new trend highs. And I mean, this thing's likely to squeeze. So if you're sitting there looking at the dollar, you're like, well, I want to play the dollar to the long side. I believe in the dollar for whatever reason. You know, I always tell people that it doesn't matter, you know, if you're bullish or bearish, you can play either side. And, you know, even if, you know, I'm a dollar bear and you're a dollar bull, you can still make money. You can still find, you know, different currencies to trade. And this is a great example of, you know, if you're a dollar bull, I'd be looking at these currencies right now. I'd be looking at the Nordic currencies thinking, man, these things are not pulling back at all.
Always buy the strong sister, not the weak sister.
Right. And but see, it's funny you say that. Most traders, they think opposite of that. They're like, okay, I'm gonna buy the weak sister because I think the weak sister is gonna catch up. But you know,
when you go to a department store, Blake, and you buy something that's real cheap, what happens to it? It breaks. Right?
Yeah.
Item that doesn't, you know, it's cheap, but it breaks.
You get what you pay for? Yeah, that type of thing.
Yeah.
All right. Speaking of weak sisters, so here's the U.S. dollar Mexican peso. I traded the U.S. dollar Mexican peso on the short side a couple of times last week. When we had this failure above these highs at the 38% retracement, I started shorting the U.S. dollar Mexican peso. I made pretty good money, like two times, just, you know, shorting this currency pair. Now it is it's being bought today, but this is one of those that if you want to play the dollar to the short side, I think this is a currency that could be a good opportunity. And I pointed this out on the week ahead video. And frankly, you know, we get a move above 19 in the U.S. dollar Mexican peso this morning, maybe like 1902, 1905. I'm a seller. So I don't mind selling this bounce. I haven't sold it yet, but it is something that I'm keeping an eye on. Let's take a look really quick at the dollar yen, because you know the dollar yen, I mentioned a little earlier, but the dollar yen, just for your reference, so you guys can all see it, we did hit the 38% retracement, okay. And we came really close to the 200-day moving average, which comes in at 111, you know, 85, 88, somewhere around here. And we came really close to that overnight. Overnight, we actually hit a new trend low, and we bounced since then. I do think that the dollar yen can still bounce a little higher. I am looking to sell the dollar yen on a rally towards 1250. The Nikkei is a little bit better bid this morning. Stocks are a little bit better bid as well. So I think that that with risk appetite stronger today, as we go into the beginning of the week, I don't necessarily think that equity market strength is going to last all week. But usually on Mondays the markets tend to be a little bit better bid. I saw a really interesting chart, Dale, that. The performance of the stock market on Mondays versus every other day was outstanding. If you strip out the rest of the week, like you take away Tuesday through Friday, and you only count the market's performance on Mondays, and what it was saying is if you bought just Monday and sold on Tuesday. For like the last couple of years, you would have like quadrupled the returns of the S&P on what it's done thus far, which tells you a lot. I mean, it tells you that, you know, mutual fund Monday, as we like to call it, is no joke. You know, you get all these buybacks and funds plowing into money at the beginning of the week, every single week. And it usually happens on, you know, Mondays, and then after that it just kind of dies down. So I thought that was an interesting statistic, and I don't know where I saw the chart a few weeks ago, but I thought it was really, really kind of interesting. But again, if Monday stays relatively well bid today, I think that the dollar yen could see, you know, 1250 or so, maybe slightly lower, maybe slightly higher. Before I started reestablishing a short position here. But that's something that.
You still think we have 11.5 to 10.5 in it?
In the dollar, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yes. I'm playing this range. And so any rally up towards, you know, 112.50, maybe even up to 113, I'm a seller because I'm still looking for 110 and lower. I was talking to you know, one of the people that I respect the most in the markets who's been in this market double the amount of time that I've been, and I've been trading for 22 years, this will be my 22nd year of trading.
But a guy
that I know that's been doing it longer than me by double, he's just, you know, we were talking on Friday, he's like, there's no reason to buy the dollar. Well, you know, that there's really no real reason to buy the dollar, and he thinks the dollar yen will very easily be down at 108, and I don't know if we're going to go all the way down to 108, but if you look at like Gregor Horvat and his counts on our blog, he's looking for a move down back down to, you know, 108, 109 before an eventual rally, and I don't know if we'll get the eventual rally. That's way too predictive for me trying to, you know, predict out how far that's going to go. But according to his wave count, that he's looking for a move down to here before a move higher. And I could very easily see that happening. So I myself am trading the dollar yen to the short side. I just don't have any exposure at the moment. And it's been a great, it really has made my entire month, you know, being short these, this last few weeks. So that's been good. And we could actually take a look at some of these other yen pairs while we're at it. And then I'd like to actually go take a look at the bond market. But if you look at the euro yen had a very key test overnight. I drew this line right here 2 weeks ago. Look at it. Look how we respected it last night. Again, this is a very similar situation. We hit new trend lows and then bounced aggressively. So that was pretty key on how that, you know, we hit new trend lows, like we hit new trend lows over here, how we hit new trend lows over here. We hit new trend lows and bounced. I don't know how big of a bounce we're going to get from, you know, from where we're at now. It might be done, but
I think it almost looks like the structure is weakening with each test. This time it got through more than before, Blake.
Yeah.
It's kind of like a ledge that's beginning to crack, because each time down there, this time it didn't hold up as well.
Well, you know what we call it? We call those a rounded top, right?
Okay.
Yeah, that's all it is. It's a rounded top. So yeah, it's choppy, but making its way lower before the sell off occurs. That's the way I see it too. It's exactly the way that you're talking about, and but you don't know when it's gonna eventually crack. It's like a weak floor that's. Right. A jackhammer's hitting it, and every time we get a little lower and then a little bit more water
sending.
You can see some light below the floor now, and it's
a metaphor.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you could look at it any which way you want, and you know, but that's kind of the way that I'm seeing it too. Is that these, we're making new lower lows and we're making lower highs, so yeah. You know. Can the euro yen bounce back to 133 before rolling over again? Sure, it can. Yeah. You know, is it going to? I mean, I don't know. I don't know where it's gonna. But yeah, I think that you know, if you get some sort of rally from, like, let's say like right here, you know, maybe a rally back up to, yeah, I guess 132.80. That's a 618 retracement of this down move. Somewhere right. Up here, I think it's going to offer a great opportunity to be on the short side. And you just got to be patient and wait for those, you know, versus saying, okay, I see what Blake's talking about. I'm just going to go ahead and get short right now because I don't want to miss it. You know, no fear of missing out here. Just, you know, no FOMO. Just, you know, let it bounce, and hopefully it bounces to the area that you're looking for, whether it's here, whether it's a 50% retracement, whether it's the 78% retracement. You got to kind of let it come to you versus you
force that way you have lower risk on the trade doing it that way.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, go ahead.
No, that's a key is, you know, you short it here, you have to risk an extra 100 pips. But if you let it come to you, you don't have to.
Right. Exactly. And so, and you're going to be much better off if you're shorting it up here than, you know, if you're short at 132.15, you're going to be much better off if you're short at 132.80. If it eventually moves down, you don't have to sit through so much pain. And, you know, so that's what I think is happening. And speaking of which, let's and then I can come back to some of these yen pairs, and then I'm going to take some questions. I want to take a look at the Nikkei. The Nikkei is actually getting a little bit of a bounce right now. You can see it on the hourly. I mean, look at, or this is a 5-minute chart rather, but you can see it on the hourly. It's, we're getting a little bit of a bounce in the Nikkei. Let it bounce. You know, let it bounce a little bit. You know, let it recover. I mean, as long as the Nikkei stays below, you know, you call it, you know, this, maybe even this high right here, 22,800, somewhere up here. You know, as long as we stay below that, I don't think there's any reason to be on the, you know, on the long side of the Nikkei, or, you know, but if the Nikkei continues to bounce before it rolls over like this, you know, it's going to pull up the yen pairs. You know, the dollar yen may rally another 15, 20 pips where I'm expecting it to, or, you know, the euro yen might actually bounce that 30 or 40 pips that we were just looking at. But you kind of got to let the Nikkei, you know, work off some of these oversold conditions, let it bounce. Gold's struggling again, but you know also, I guess I should point this out too. Did you see the massive breakout in silver from Friday?
Yeah.
And somebody in our chat room, when we were trading at 1732, we were right about here on Friday, somebody's like, oh man, look at silver breaking out. I'm like, this is the time that you want to tighten stops. And, but what's really interesting is if you look at silver and how it's performing right now, silver is paused right at this, like, you know, perfect retest of this broken trend line. So silver, you know, I don't trade gold or silver, but this would be the place that you got to start looking at, you know, being long silver somewhere down here. Gold also, you know, seeing a free pullback.
Steve's triangle to the upside then.
Yeah, I think he was looking at, and you know, correct
he
me.
He thought we'd go to the downside because it was a coming off a down move. But yeah, I've been talking 1310. I still think it's doable.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, gold and silver both look very constructive, and they had really good moves. They had really, really good moves late last week. Let's take a real quick look at just some other yen pairs. And like I said, I'm going to answer some questions here in a moment. So here is the pound yen. Pound yen had very, very messy, but you can see the support zone's pretty key. This is from, I drew this out last week, and we got a nice,
looks like the euro yen, Blake, where the board with the board again.
Yeah, we might be giving this a rounded top here as well. You know, we have an ABCD that could take us down to 146. I don't have any pound yen short, but this looks like we're, you know, it's very choppy, but you know, like I would focus on the short side of these versus the long side. So yeah, you got to use these rallies to take your shot at them if you're going to trade them. The pound, I'm a little bit more, I'm not as excited about because I think the pound's so choppy. But yeah, I mean, here's the Aussie yen. The Aussie yen, it broke this major trend line here and support zone. So I think any rally now to 85, what is this, 85.35, somewhere around there, if you can get, you could get some sort of rally, it would be a good opportunity to be on the short side. New Zealand yen, you know, I'm looking for a move down to the 161% extension from here. And I don't know, I explained this on Friday. I was looking for a bounce, and we're already starting to see a little bit of a bounce, but anytime a bounce you want to sell into. And then Canadian yen, this is that failed inverted head and shoulder pattern, you know, breakdown. And this is another one that, yeah, it may have found some support at the 618, but if you can just get a rally, just, you know, a little bit of a recovery, maybe back up to here, you know, like this. And then look to sell rallies, because they're all choppy, but they're all starting to make lower lows. And so if you can just use that as an opportunity to take advantage of those, you know, those lower lows. So on rallies, you can short them before they make a new high, and they can have that lower low, lower high. Then you got this downtrend established. So then you just sell these on rallies if you can get them. But it's the important part is trying to stay patient while this is all going on. I know it's tempting to just get in and say, oh, screw it, I'm just going to get in now and just get short here. But I'd rather be short in this particular case. I'd rather be short up here at 89.30 than be short at 88 or 87.80. So
I've heard, Blake, I've heard you use the term when, you know, you may have a longer term bias and you'll just put an infinitesimal piece on. What do you call that again?
I like to track them. So sometimes, like, I'm a
tracker. Yeah, it makes me pay attention.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Like, yeah. Like I might put on a quarter size position just to keep it on keep it on my screen. But you know, in cases like this, I'd rather wait a little bit before starting to get my way in. Like if I think that a massive breakout is occurring right now, then I might put in a tracker and then look to buy dips or, you know, sell rallies. If I think something major is afoot. Yeah, it's I put in a it's a like, you know, when you're in the military, at least when I was in the Marine Corps, we'd have tracer rounds, and a tracer round is like every fourth or fifth shot is something that you can track. So at night, you know, you kind of know where you're firing and the flight of the round when you're firing down range.
Lights up.
Huh?
It lights up.
Yeah, it lights up. It traces the market. Is Stelios back? I don't know if he'd made his way back yet.
I am here, my friend.
Hey, Stelios, could I pass you the charts for about 5 minutes? Is that
yeah,
possible?
Sure.
Okay, and maybe you and Dale can go over a couple of things, and I can come back and answer a couple of questions. I need to step out for about 5 minutes.
No problem.
All right, it's coming over to you right now. I'll be right back, guys.
Hi, Stel.
Oh, hey. So I don't know. Oh, do we have any questions, or shall we have a look at?
Yeah, I want to see some of your charts. So you're still bearish this dollar index? Looking
yeah.
For 88.
Yeah, I mean this is a chart. This is a monthly chart. I drew these lines, you know, 4 or 5 months ago. So, and I still think there might be a bounce higher for the dollar, you know, could be. I thought when we hit 95 and a bit, I thought we were going to get to 96 and then, you know, perfectly tag that. We didn't, but I am still, I'm still bearish.
We still could.
Yeah.
We still could.
And let's remember the DXY is 50% euro dollar. So if the euro squeezes or continues to squeeze, then that's going to bring down the dollar, no matter what the dollar does. Compared to other currencies. So this is another one I am still looking, and I've said this before, this is one of the main reasons why I'm also bullish silver, apart from fundamentals, but I am bullish silver because I am bearish a dollar as well. So it's something that I just keep looking. And this is the chart I open when I wake up. I know it's only a monthly chart, so it's not gonna move much, but I just open it first up just to remind myself what the main game plan is, because we all know that the dollar affects pretty much everything. So
that's a great tip.
Yeah, I mean, you know, as I said before, it's a monthly chart, so it's not going to change from one day to the next, but I just like to remind myself every day when I wake up about what I'm trying to do.
So we're almost near the end of the month. Looks like we have an inside month working here.
Yes, yes.
The neutral month.
Yeah.
I like those because the next month could set up an outside candle, you know, take out this month's high and then start trading lower. Yeah.
And or I wonder I wonder what seasonality is like for the dollar, you know, year end. I actually should know this, but I don't. I don't know if it's if it tends to rally into year end or to sell off. I'm going to research on that and then come back. So that's the main chart I look at. I've got other another one which I really love. Wrong chart here. There we go. Weekly. Another chart which I drew weeks ago. It's not playing out exactly, but this is Sterling Kiwi, which still is one of my favorite longs for Sterling. I had it, I got out, I'm looking for another entry now. But
look at that gap. Is that from today? Yeah.
This is
from the beginning of the month.
No, this is a weekly one. So this is
weekly. Okay. It's from Friday.
Yeah, but it's weird.
It's like a breakaway gap. Breakaway gap.
I don't remember it jumping that much. This is interesting. What if we go on the daily? No, there is a gap. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a nice gap, man.
Yeah. So this is another one.
It's filling it either.
Yeah. It's another one I'm looking at, and ideally I wanted to drop back towards the zone because I really, really want to be long Sterling against the Kiwi. I may have missed this. When it was at 191.5, I was thinking about it, but I tend to stick with what the plan is. I sometimes I'm a bit too rigid, and I always said to myself, I'm going to load up when it gets to around 190.5, and it just never got there. So unfortunately, I've missed that. But really, it's kind of following what the path I thought would be. And I really do think this is going to 2 and maybe higher. So we got this fib here. There's a 38.
So Blake would put a tracker on.
Yeah.
He'd have a small piece in case it is a major breakout and you don't get a pullback.
Yeah.
Just so you're there. I'm just, passing on Blake Morrow's style of trading. And it's hard to be perfect. It's hard to expect perfection at the crap table.
Yeah, so, I mean, nobody's
perfect. Look at the whole chart. It's the first gap I've seen going back to, I don't see him anywhere else on the chart. That could be, and remember, that's how the euro came out after the French elections, with a breakaway gap that people waited 1,000 pips to see if they could buy a gap fill.
Yeah, no,
this
absolutely.
One doesn't look like it's going to be filled. Just my opinion.
Yeah, yeah, no, I agree. And this pair, actually, I like it a lot because it trades very technically, like these zones which go a long way back. They tend to get respected quite well. So another reason why I really love this pair. Although the bad thing with it is that it can move 200 pips on a single day and just destroy you if your stops are too tight or your leverage too high, etc. So it's a really, really tough pair to trade. I always trade this with zero leverage because I just find it scary the way it moves. So
let's see your silver chart with the breakout that we had. I'm interested in where your lines are.
Yeah, this again, the lines I drew, this is a weekly chart, so I drew these lines over 2 months ago, and I really did draw that. If you go back, you will see I drew that line that would come and test this resistance zone, which this zone was pretty big. Then it came down, and then it's trying to decide to start on the upside again. The big level, which corresponds to about 1310 in gold, is 1740. That's been, if you go to a shorter term chart, I think it was 1740-ish. Yeah, I tried a couple of times here. I didn't manage to do it. And that coincides, as I said, with about 1310 on gold, which is, again, another huge level. So I like, I really like, I like silver. Like Steve and Blake keep saying, it's a frustrating pair instrument right now because it's going nowhere. But I like it in the medium term. I don't mind waiting, months for this to work out. Because as I've said in the past, the last 2 or 3 years, I've gone long silver 4 times, I think. Yeah, this is the 4th time. And I've caught, again, it trades quite technically. I went long on this zone when it looks like it's going to breach this zone. I went long here. I got long again there and again there. So, and now I'm again long but I'm at the money now, so I'm not positive or negative, but I think it's gonna, I think it's gonna go.
You think silver's gonna, I still think silver's, you know, probably gonna make its way higher too, so.
You know,
does the gold look better? Does the gold look better than the silver?
For me, when I look at the gold silver ratio, and sometimes, and I prefer silver.
Okay,
because the ratio is
near the highs.
Oh, 90? I don't remember. No, 90. No, I think it's a bit lower. It's about, is it 90? I can't remember. And I don't
know. Yeah, it's up there.
How'd you do it? You do like
a reversion to the mean would take it to 40.
XAU.
Oh, it, like in one go?
Yeah.
Sorry, like that? No. XAGXAU. Like that? No.
I think that, doesn't that work?
I don't know.
Valid.
Yeah, I forget. I forget how we do the gold silver ratio. It's been it's been a while since I've looked at it. So did Dale? Do you have an interview today set up?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I have Jay Chandran, and he trades the Nifty 50. So
okay,
shifting our attention over to India.
Cool. Really quick. Let me see if I can address a couple of questions. Okay. And Stelios, thanks for taking it over. I'll go ahead and I'll just grab a couple of these quick questions really fast. I don't know where I'm trying to see where I'm at here. Hold on really quick. Brett asked about the US dollar Turkish lira. Let's take a look. I haven't actually looked at Turkish lira since sometime last week. Now look at how strong that is. We're approaching these trend highs. This is a nasty currency to trade. It really is. I mean, this is one of those you don't want to be stuck on the wrong side of this trade. I've done this on. I've traded this several occasions. I haven't traded it recently, but man, look at that. That looks pretty damn bullish. What's happening over there in Turkey, there, Stelios?
I mean, the usual, you know, the government there, Erdogan. I mean, I'm not an expert in Turkish politics, but he's just taking a more and more, you know, authoritarian rule, and it's just, you know, Turkey is one of the countries with the least freedom in terms of press, in terms of you know, all these things. So it seems like a dangerous place, you know, and politically it's just bubbling, and I don't know what's going to happen.
Oh, okay. Well, the lira looks just very much like it's going to get destroyed here. Very divergent. This is a weekly chart. Very divergent relative strength. Even on the daily, it looks a little. I think if it makes its way higher in the new highs, it has a lot of room to go. I mean, a lot of room to run. This thing looks like it could continue to, you know, rally towards, yeah, 440, I guess, would be a target. But it looks bullish. I wouldn't want to be on the short side of that. Sure as hell not. Ronan has a lot of comments, but it's hard to read through all your comments, Ronan, because you're making comments on things. Yeah. Barry says the US dollar, South African Rand looking good for a long, or he said US dollar, Rand, US dollar, but let's take a look at the, so you were talking about long, which would be short the US dollar, South African Rand. Yeah. I don't know. This looks like very messy to me. I don't see any reason to actually be trading this one at all. Like not in the least bit. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, it just, you know, if I'm not seeing anything, that doesn't mean you can't see anything. I'm just saying for me, it doesn't look, you know, like there's no reason for me to be on, you know, on the long or short side of this. Although that it did hit the 38% retracement, I guess that's good. But, you know, from a timing perspective, I wouldn't want to, I don't know. So I'd necessarily want to be short just yet, because we aren't making lower, we're not making lower lows. We're still making higher highs and for all intents and purposes, higher lows too. So If you think it's going to make a lower high, then you have to wait for a rally, maybe back up to like 1440, something like this, you know, like that, and then look to take it on the short side. That's how I would trade it if you were going to force my hand to trade it. Ziggy said Turkey may leave NATO, and I guess that could possibly happen. But guys and gals, I'm gonna really quick before Dale starts his interview, which is gonna start here momentarily. Just a couple things to really focus on. I think you gotta keep an eye on these yen pairs. Let them rally another, you know, 15, 20 pips on the dollar yen. I think the dollar yen is gonna struggle once it gets to 1250. It hasn't even really responded with the Nikkei rallying the way it's rallied just over the last, you know, few hours. The dollar yen's barely got a leg up. So, you know, if we make it up towards 1250, you got to keep this one on the radar as a possible short. And other than that, that's really what my focus is on today. Dale, I guess we're going to pass it over to you so you can start your interview.
All right, man. Thank you, Blake.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Stel, nice analysis.
Thanks, yes, man.
Thank you,
way to step in. And Jay, welcome to FACE. Looking forward to speaking with you and making you the presenter now. And look forward to hearing your voice and seeing your screen, my friend.
My screen?
Hi, Jay.
Yeah, am I audible?
You're there. Look at that market profile.
Yeah.
Okay, so you are taking me back 30 years because floor traders were the only ones I knew that used market profile. And you're only the second person I've interviewed out of almost 1,000 that I've done that uses market profiles. Kudos to you, Jay. Thanks for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Thanks for bringing me in. So,
okay. All right, so we're turning our eyes to the Far East, and you also prove another thing I say. You don't have to trade 100 different things. Guys I knew on the floor never left the same trading pit and knew one market like the back of their hand. Is that how it is for you with the Nifty? You're completely concentrated on it, correct?
Yeah, exactly. I read, Nifty for past 7 years. I'm trading this alone.
Okay. All right. So you know every important technical level like the back of your hand. So tell me this, Jay, because it happens so many times in my interview, and I read a little bit about your background and how you got in. One guy gave you a bad option trade, and then your brother gave you a good one that, you know, went up eightfold. And that was the beginning of your trading career. Why did so many engineers gravitate towards the trading industry? Do you know?
Probably due to the profit factor.
The profit to make money. They wouldn't make as an engineer?
Yeah, exactly. Okay.
So no matter the profession, we all have the same motive, right? But they're also very technical type of people, and they really gravitate towards technical analysis. I, you know, always knew that anytime I was soliciting an account as a commodity broker, that engineers love to trade. They were very good prospects.
Exactly. So probably the real motive engineers come into trading, at least is the profit factor they see in the markets. I mean, like quick money, easy to crack. They crack engineering, so easy to crack. So that's the mindset before setting into the markets. They all.
So how did you find market profile to use as your dominant tool for trading Nifty 50? Did you go through a process of trying other things before you got here?
Yeah, exactly. So I use market profile, not in a similar way what Dalton says or what a textbook says. I just fit market profile for Nifty? How, I mean, every instrument have a different characteristic. So it is like you can't use the same method over all the instruments. So each have a different characteristic. So you need to watch trial and error to see what fits what. So then from there, you start developing what works more. So work on what works more. So that's how I use market profile in a typical manner. What I see, lot of setups have a higher probability and higher edge working on Nifty.
Is there a time frame? Are we looking at a daily profile right now on your screen?
We are looking at a 30-minute profile each day separated into a.
Is that the time frame you day trade off of, Jay?
I use this for my to read my context for the day. So I go into my 3-minute time frame and 5-minute time frame to look and for the entries. So I use this chart for my for the day. Where can be the edge? What sort of edge can be found? So I used to gauge using this chart. Then I go to my 3-minute chart here over there. So I'll see what kind of trade opportunity presents and where the least entry could be. I mean, like a very low risk entry I can get.
Okay, so it also looks like you trade different sectors within the Nifty 50, right? I saw banking. So do you break it down into different sectors too?
Yeah, exactly. So mostly I trade banks, metals, sometimes IT, information technology.
Okay. So you want to give us a brief tutorial on what you see? You know, we see all these letters and thing brackets on our market profile, and kind of tell us what it tells you.
Exactly. So what for me market profile is, how I use market profile is, I want to see where the maximum trade is going to get a pain. So I wait for such a moment. I mean, for my swing trades, I'm narrating the trade process. For intraday, I will give a different view. So for my swing process, I'm telling you what kind of setup I read. So for my swing process, I just wait for traders to get in where I get a maximum pain for a reflex action. So for example, if you see this, this area in particular. So we had a very low volatility followed by a high volatility followed by a low volatility. So basically after a breakout, market started bracketing.
Okay. So here. So you bracket the range you expect for that time period.
Yeah. Once market starts bracketing.
And if it breaks out of that, does it ever break out of those brackets? And is that a signal as well when it comes out of your brackets? Or you mainly just, or it stays within?
Yeah, whether a bracket goes out or I get a breakout failure, I wait for that. So here on this day, on 6th of November.
Yeah.
One second, I'll make it. See here, on 6th of November, if you split it, so again here, market went above range extended high, then all of a sudden it came back in.
Right.
So this is where I will look for some sort of swing opportunity to me, where these longs all get caught.
Okay, so they're trapped up there.
Yeah, trapped up. See, basically, after seeing this breakout, a balance and a keep of balance, I look for some sort of, sometimes it might break out and keep scaling higher. But as a mean reversion trader, I look for these kind of trap setups. So okay. Where it range extended higher. And here, if you see, there is a huge volume chunk happened here. And then all of a sudden, it came back inside the value, closed in the middle.
Okay. So have you noticed with market profile that breakout failures are also big trades because they have people so wrong-footed?
Exactly. So that is where the opposite move will come in a faster manner.
Oh, yes. Is so down where, faster?
I mean, yeah, exactly.
Okay. All right. So
the next day.
Go ahead.
So here the next day market opened and rejected very swiftly. So this is where I look for an entry here. So I shorted and I kept a stop loss above this range. So where my targets would be is I will be looking for these kind of VPOCs. VPOCs as in these are virgin POCs. POC is point of control where the maximum where on a any particular given day where price spent maximum time. So if you see, these are the broadened letters. These are POCs of any given day where market spent much time in this way.
Okay.
So once I initiate the trade, I will for these VPOCs to test my target zone.
Okay.
So here, before this trade, we got some VPOC here,
right.
Here. So once I get a trade initiation here, so I place my stop loss and I will be looking for this trade VPOC zones as a target. In between, I will manage the trade. So how I initiated a swing trade is I will just put a test size here to see the depth of. As Livermore says, I mean, like, never go in one shot all your quantity. Just test it. Whether the trigger is working on your favor. So once the test trigger goes very well, put the next sizes on. Because your target, you can keep managing the two. So okay. Here, I went 20% short of my initial quantity. I kept my stop loss here. Even if it takes, I will be losing with my 25% quantity. So then once it showed its sign on any pullback, I kept adding it. So I will be looking for the targets on the swing back. I'll be until a trend changes, I will be keep managing the position till it ends. So it came till all the way to this final VPOC zone, 220, where on this day I covered my shorts which initiated on this
okay.
day. So this is how my profile in a way for swing trade where I just wait for the big, I mean, I won't say for the trap traders to get trapped.
Okay. So now they're trapped down here. They were trapped at the top and now they're trapped down here. Okay.
Exactly, see here. Starts balancing. So here, this could be the last, I mean, like, these shots are emotional shots, mostly.
How do you know they're emotional? How do you know? What is the profile? Are there any teardrops dropping from any of those markings? Are they crying?
Yeah, I will just put print screen on this, I will explain it. So how I see a trap, this is getting balanced.
Okay.
So all of this today on the second session, if it goes and swiftly comes back into the balance, then I feel these shots doesn't have any edge because they are not defending their position.
Yeah, they have FOMO, fear of missing out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And moreover, if you see, they are missed the shots here and they are shorting in a zone where it was a previous huge demand zone. If you see this.
Yeah.
is where markets started rising, and the value being definitely higher. So this zone being tested first, I mean, it's a first read. See this zone? The zone being tested first.
Could you give us could you give us kind of a look at, you know, we've had melt ups in almost every global market for the, you know, for the last year. Has the Nifty 50 been performing as strongly as, say, the S&P or the Dow, or what's its relative performance been to other stock markets across the world?
Nifty 50 has, sorry, come again? I couldn't hear.
Okay. So it's been underperforming?
It's not market underperforming.
Do we see do we see a long-term chart of the Nifty? Like a daily or weekly of the Nifty?
This one is a daily chart.
I'm saying we, but I want to see it. I'm selfish. Okay, there it is. Okay. All right. So, 30%.
Yeah.
From last year. Pretty nice. Show me the action in the market when your prime minister made certain notes illegal. Yeah. Where was that period when you guys went to a cashless type? Are you laughing? How was that for you? Was it inconvenient? Why you laughing? Ronan wasn't laughing. Why are you laughing? It's funny? I never thought I'd get that reaction, but that's good. You won't say anything. Okay. All right. Where was it? Down there?
Okay. I'm taking my marker here. So this was the period. Okay.
All right. Did you have to burn any of your cash?
Nothing like.
All right. Oh God! Thank you for giving. Yeah, thank you for the good humor. Because I know a lot of people went through a lot of heartache. So, why don't you do this? I went to your website. You have a great website, and show it to the crowd and people that may have an interest in trading the Nifty 50. And we know India's one of the, you know, biggest growth engines in the world today, and the largest democracy. And I know a lot of people that like emerging markets are very constructive on India. So people need to pay attention to what's happening in your country, you know, the prime minister doing draconian things, but the economy there has a lot of potential. So there's your website.
Yeah, this is my website. Look at you.
You fly. Like, you're kind of like that super Nifty. You're like Superman there. All right. You know, you have a fan in our community. Do you know Ronit? That's the handle he uses.
Yeah.
All right. He's a fan.
Okay.
So you have a trading room too.
Yeah, I have a trading room as well. We write blog everyday trade plan. We write some sort of, how to overcome a few of the trading problems traders incur. And we also put some chart setups for learning. So we used to post these kind of trade, here, what is the edge? It'll be an interesting article for people who doesn't know what is an edge and trade, how I define an edge, all this stuff.
Okay. So there's a great resource for everyone watching Jay live now and that will look at the video later to, you know, I believe that people should also open up themselves to different asset classes. I mean, who knew it was going to be cryptocurrency 10 years ago? And, you know, things come in and out of fashion. And I'm keeping my eye on India. I think it's the biggest democratic experiment out there. And just with the population and the move towards more being able to have more of a middle class lifestyle, that the growth is in Asia. How do things look politically between, say, India and Pakistan right now? Is there always tension? Does it wane? You know,
It is like a kind of always. It won't be always tension, but I mean, like once in a 3 months or once. I mean, like this Kashmir issue always will be a tension. I mean, like.
Yeah, because you know people forget that you're both nuclear powers. You both are. And how about Modi's relationship with Xi in China? How's that going?
It's going smooth as of now. I mean, like nothing. I mean, like there is not any big thing happening over there with China.
Okay. So Ronit's saying that the local state politics are really what the population has their attention on, rather than the federal and the geopolitical with other nations. So I guess everyone's concentrated on, you know, their own locality. But I guess that's the way it is everywhere. You know, New Yorkers care more about New York than they do about California. So anyway, it was really, really a pleasure meeting you. I appreciate you coming to see us. Did you want to wrap it with anything on market profile?
Just wrap it with my view on Nifty going forward, what I'm looking for. So then I will come. So basically what we had seen here is, see this zone where last time on November 16th, where they initiated a long here around, I mean, like 10,170.
Right.
And exactly this last week, they held the same zone here.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll just show here. This is where they had initiated the trade here, the zone, and good gap. So here they had held the zone, same zone here, and they kept driving it. So here, now it's been locked between two P-box, one here and one here, 220 and 345. So tomorrow, I'm expecting market to stay within this range for next 2 days. I mean, today it's completed. Tomorrow, I expect some sort of balancing formation here. Then I expect a move towards 380 and this VPOC at 455, which is this VPOC zone here.
Okay.
So going forward, looking, I'm bullish.
Looking for sideways and then a continuation rally.
Exactly. So looking for a sideways move. So basically from Wednesday, I'm expecting a one-shot move to 455 and even 500. So what sellers going to do this will be the key next swing trigger. So as of now, I'm bullish on markets. I will be looking for 455. This is my first target. And if it's been stretched, it can go to 510 levels, 10,510. So where this setup could go, failure would be somewhere below 10,205. So I'll be expecting some sort of balancing formation tomorrow. Then a move towards 345, 380, and 450. So that's my view on now.
Okay, well, thank you for showing us market profile, leaving us with a forecast and everything. Thank you for taking time out today, Jay. And it's been great meeting you and showing us a little something that we normally don't look at to broaden our horizons. And you have a great looking website, and I'm proud to call you my trading warrior brother. And hope that the rest of 2017 goes great for you, that money rains down on you, whether it's digital or paper, on you and your family for the rest of 2017 and beyond.
Thanks a lot, Dave. Thanks for bringing me. Thanks.
All right, my friend. Everyone, that's Jay Chandra, and you could follow him at Nifty Wizard. And that's also his website, www.niftywizard.com. We'll see everyone tomorrow for Turnaround Tuesday. Enjoy the rest of your day. And remember, don't just count your pips, count your blessings. Adios. Thank you, Jay.
Thank you, Bill.
You're welcome, Alina. See you, Ronan.